Well, welcome to Hillcrest Live. I am glad that you made it. You found it. I'm sorry about the five-minute intro. You know, we had a lot of great comments from people that have said, hey, do the intro because it takes us a while to figure out how to get to Facebook page. And actually, right now, we are streaming also on YouTube on a scheduled stream, which we've never been able to figure out. We did it tonight, and I would say, I can tell you we figured it out. But I didn't. I don't know how I did it. Somehow I did it. I'll retrace my steps and figure out how we did this. But we are currently streaming to YouTube and to Facebook. I think I said Facebook. I meant YouTube. We are streaming to YouTube and not sure how we did that. And we have one viewer over there. So welcome, whoever you are. But here on Facebook, 4950 people, glad that you made it. I hope that you are having a great week, and I have been looking so forward to doing this Hillcrest Live thing at 7 o'clock on Thursdays. I wanted to start it last week, but forgot that it was my birthday. So we're kicking it off tonight, and I'm glad that you're here. And I just want to be a bit of an encouragement to you, because I don't know exactly how you're feeling, but I know that most of us are a little shell-shocked as to what's been going on, this whole social distancing thing and working from home and doing school at home. And we just want life to get back to normal, and there's just nothing normal happening. And something can be a novelty for a while and feel okay, but it starts to drain on us. And I've felt myself slipping into some feelings of frustration and depression and even just overall just upset about everything. And I said, you know what? I need to do something positive. I need to have something to look forward to, something that I can have a little bit of fun with. And so that's kind of what birthed this whole idea of Hillcrest Live. Now, my wife, when I was telling her about this, and I said, you know, I'm doing this thing, Hillcrest Live, she said, isn't that a bit confusing? I'm like, cool. Why is that confusing? She says, well, what's Sunday morning? Isn't that live? I'm like, well, yeah, they're both live. She said, well, it's going to be confusing because people are going to think Hillcrest Live is the Sunday morning thing. It's going to be confusing. And I said, well, you're probably right. And she said, well, then change the name. And I said, well, I can't. I already made the logo. So it is what it is. Thursday night, 7 o'clock, Hillcrest Live, Sunday morning, live worship service or live worship. I don't know. Yeah, I get it. It's kind of confusing, but it's the way it is. That's how we're going to do it. Tonight, as you comment, usually I have a little bit of help with comments, because as I look at the screen and the comments, you know, just like with you, they're growing by. In fact, if you want to watch, if you've got a phone and you want to watch it landscape instead of profile, turn it landscape. You want to see the comments, then just swipe from the right to the left, and all the comments will sweep into the page and you'll still see them on landscape. I don't know if you knew that. I discovered that accidentally when I dropped my phone. But as the comments go by, it's hard for me to pay attention to comments that are directed directly to me or to the show before they go by. And also, Facebook puts about a 15 to 20 second delay on what I say before it gets to you. And so sometimes if you're commenting, I'm gonna miss that comment because it's 15 or 20 seconds after something I'm talking about. So on Sunday morning, Pastor Brian always helps me out. And he's scanning the comments and commenting all the time. And then he throws those comments my direction so that I can pay attention to just the comments that are relating to the service or something that we're specifically doing. You comment to each other, you keep that going. But just know tonight I'm kind of on my own with it. And so I don't have, Brian's out helping with the food distribution tonight. And somebody missed their shift. And so he's in there doing that. Normally he'd be sending those things to me. But tonight is kind of a one-man show, but the program or this show is kind of designed to do that. And so all I have is what's in front of me here. I've got my computer. I don't even have my keyboard. I just have a mouse. And if I have to use this mouse, that means I'm probably getting into trouble. And if I need the keyboard, it's off to the side here. If I pull that out, I'm real big trouble. What I'm trying to do is just use this thing called a Stream Deck, in which if I push these buttons, it's like a magic production crew and all kinds of cool stuff happens that we have programmed into this little box. And so if I kick it or unplug it, we're toast. So if I have to stop and re-engage stuff, I apologize for that, but hopefully I'll just push these buttons and they're going to do exactly what I told them to do and we're not going to have any problem at all. But who knows? You never really know. Each week as we go through this, we're going to have certain segments of the show that are going to be regulars, like each week. There's other segments that maybe we'll do one week, but maybe we'll skip it for a few weeks and do it again. Like, for example, I might be coming and doing some things with recipes because, people are like, we're going to have like a little cooking demonstration. I'm going to show you some really cool things because I saw a meme the other day in which this gal, she's like draped over the kitchen. She's like, I think I made 450 meals during this COVID-19. And I think we're all feeling that way. And we're repeating recipes like, I need some creativity. And not all of us are Dina Perry, pampered chef and able to just figure it all out. So we need a little help with that. And I enjoy cooking and I like to make fun of cooking. So, and maybe we'll even have Dina on, through as a guest or something through a video call or something. Cause her and Burke do an amazing job with their little videos that they do. So we're going to have all kinds of different things. There are other segments where we can do one of them and then we'll never do it again, but we're going to have some repeat ones. I want to start off today, though, talking a little bit about what went on this last Sunday. So I want to opine about that a little bit. If you've never heard that word opine, to opine is to talk about something you have an opinion about or to express your opinions or your thoughts. So I call this segment Opining on the Opining. Yes, so that amazing graphic, that title, yes, I created that. I know you're like, that is amazing. Yeah, you can expect more of that because for each of these little segments, I have a little intro. And so if you have a skill set and would like to help me with those intros, I would love it because that's about as good as they get. Well, we'll see. I've got a few more for you. But this last Sunday, I got to talk about kind of a cool little story as we looked at Zacchaeus, the wee little man. And one of the things that I loved about this story, and as I got comments from you, I think many of you were at least intrigued with this idea. I like this story because there is this possible connection. You have to come to some rational understanding as to how when Jesus walks up to Zacchaeus, that first of all, why he walks up to him, and secondly, how he knows his name. And that the text is clear that Jesus knows this guy's name, that they haven't met before. And, I opined about the idea that maybe Jesus knew Zacchaeus through Matthew, who was a tax collector about 60 or 70 miles north in Galilee. And that when Matthew became a follower of Jesus and created a ruckus or a stir up there, that maybe that information made it down. And maybe even Zacchaeus could have had some understanding or even some interactions with tax collectors up there. We don't really know because history doesn't really tell us how they're connected together. But nonetheless, there was something there. And so I loved that about the story. Now, yep, I got a little carried away with some of my jokes, my short jokes. I'm going to do that sometimes, but it's all in good fun. And I hope, well, you were very forgiving of my terrible jokes. So thank you for that. And I am, I loved last Sunday and I love that teaching and just looking forward to some more stuff that we've got coming up here in the future. But you can always ask questions during the service. You can ask questions after the service. And if I can't get to something during the service, like tonight, I'm going to just have a hard time getting to stuff in the service. Maybe I can look at some of these things and say, hey, Thomas Friesen, he's watching. Aaron Levese says, it's totally awesome. I don't even know what Aaron's referring to, but that was 20 seconds ago to whatever I was saying. So I am able to respond sometimes during, but certainly after. I'll take the time afterwards to look at comments, respond to things. So if you've got questions, ask the questions. I'll do my best to respond to them. Now, Easter Sunday was a great Sunday too. 2 weeks ago, Sabrina Simons was watching our service from the comfort of her own couch or wherever she was sitting. And she decided to put the stream through her through a filter. And so as I was preaching on Easter Sunday, and you all were watching what you thought was a very normal service, Sabrina, on the other hand, had me as a rabbit. Yes, so I was preaching as a rabbit. And if that is not interesting enough, as the service went on, she had me with a rabbit on my head. And I don't know if it stayed there or if it jumped off, but if you're having some fun with some of our images, send them our way because we'd love to show others with it too. And Sabrina, thank you for keeping it interesting. I just wish I could have benefited from that, but I am definitely glad that I did not have a rabbit actually on my head for sure. As we interact with others, and it's our faith, our Christianity, even Jesus himself finds himself in the news. And when Christianity or our faith is in the news, sometimes it's awesome because of how the stories are. Like right now, there's so much in the news about the Empower Sioux Falls and all the work that's being done. And Brian and Rich McCorris are on the front lines of that with the COVID helps. And it's great to see Christianity in the news like that. Churches coming together, people coming together for the good of the community. There's other times that Christianity or the church is in the news and it's kind of cringeworthy. But I spend a lot of time reading Christian news or news about Christians or about faith or about the Bible or about Jesus, whether it's archaeological or whether it's current events that are taking place. And so I thought I would do a segment each week about something that I found in the news that I think is kind of interesting. So for this segment, I'm going to call this Jesus in the News. This just in. Over in Mississippi, a church in Greenville named Temple Baptist Church held a drive-in church service, and attendees, I got a picture of them here, and attendees were written $500 tickets. $500 per person for coming to this drive-in worship service. Pastor Scott, who is the pastor there at Temple Baptist, said that his congregation is an older congregation, and they don't have smartphones, they don't have ways to connect online, so he invites them to come to the parking lot at the designated time on Sunday morning, and he has spots that are designated for each car. The information on the distance that those cars need to be from each other was given to him by the CDC. He said that people have to stay in their cars during the service and their windows have to remain rolled up. And then he broadcasts to them through a low-powered FM transmitter so they can tune in on their radio and hear what's going on as he teaches and as they do their worship service. But when the police showed up to issue the tickets, Pastor Scott, who knew that they were coming because he was having a bit of a fight with the local municipal there, he pointed them to the drive-in restaurant that was just down the street and said, Right now, that drive-in restaurant is serving multiple cars that are pulling up for a drive-in restaurant, and their windows are even down. So why are they able to do that, yet we cannot do a worship service? Well, believe it or not, the Department of Justice has gotten involved on the case, and they are in support of Temple Baptist and their right to be able to do it because they did it in the guidelines that CDC had set out. The church has now filed a lawsuit against the city. So if you go to Greenville in Mississippi, you can find a worship service maybe happening soon at Temple Baptist under the acceptance of the city. So, yeah, we'll see. What have you been up to this week? What have you been doing? Spending some time doing a hobby, maybe? Maybe reading a good book? Maybe you're starting to do something you haven't done before, pick up something you haven't done in the past. Maybe you're just fighting with each other. I don't know what you're doing, but I am curious in what you're doing. And so each week, I'm going to kind of find out what you're doing. Now, I don't have anything tonight. I'm not able to connect with anyone tonight, but soon we'll have like video callers coming in, telling us what they're doing, showing us what they're doing. But tonight, I'm going to tell you a little bit about what I'm doing in a segment called Whatcha Doing. Whatcha doing? Whatcha doing? I really want to know. Whatcha doing? Whatcha doing? Can I be part of the show? Okay, first of all, what you're doing right now, you should be sharing this with your friends. You should hit the share button and then send it out to your friends. Say, you guys got to check this out because this is about the craziest thing that a church has ever done is this Hillcrest Live thing that happens on Thursday nights. So hit the share button, let people know. That also kind of moves this forward in the Facebook world and allows us to have a wider audience of people that can hear what's going on here and get connected and get involved. But the thing that I have been doing this last week is turning 50 years old. That's right, the big 5-0. And people have asked me, what is it like being 50 years old? Well, it's half a century. My eyesight's not as good. Things hurt. But I'm wicked smart now. I wasn't before, but I woke up at 50, wicked smart. Wisdom off the charts. So finally, wisdom is matched up with my gray hair just before it all falls out. So that's a really great thing for me. Now, seriously, 50 is great. I love it. I've never been one that gets too hung up on like that an age means something unique or different. They are milestones. They are worth celebrating. But 50 is just another year like 49 was and like 51 will be. But it is 5-0. And I love it. And I got the privilege of having a birthday during a pandemic. Now, you can look at a birthday in a pandemic and say, that's a real bummer. Who wants to have a birthday during a pandemic? Because you can't do any of the birthday stuff that you were able to do before. That is true. And you could get seriously depressed on that and be a big, you know, pouty lip on your birthday. But I would say, why don't you like, you know, turn those lemons into lemonade and realize that you get to do some stuff on your birthday during a pandemic that you never get to do on a regular non-pandemic birthday. I mean, think of all the non-pandemic birthdays you've had. If you have one during a pandemic, is the only time you're going to do some of these things. Now, my wife and my son came and picked me up, kind of, you know, just scooped me up out of church. And my wife said, you're going to be gone for an hour and a half. I'm like, whoa, okay, what are we doing? We drove down to Centerville. I love going down to Centerville because there's one thing in Centerville. There is the Royal Bake Shop, the Royal Bakery, in which they have the most amazing donuts on planet Earth. And I've got a picture of me in front of the Royal Bake Shop with my glazed donuts and my zebra donuts. My wife pre-ordered a dozen because if you show up there mid-morning, you're getting nothing. And I tell you, that case was empty and mine was the last one on the shelf. She was happy to sell them to me. And we ate those all the way home. I had them at work. I got sick on my birthday, but it was worth every bit of it. That night, coming together, it's tough because we weren't coming together as a whole family. We've not been in the direct presence of my parents for a few weeks now, trying to keep them safe as our family is kind of high risk in some of the things that are going on with us. And so we want to keep my parents safe so we're not in their presence. And so it's really tough on a birthday when you're not able to do that. But just before my little house party started up, my wife said, hey, we need to go out front because someone's bringing something by and you know, we want to meet them outside instead of, you know, having them come in and all that kind of stuff. So I'm like, yeah, okay, that's cool. So I went outside and of course my wife had decorated the house and there were balloons that's forked in the lawn and all kinds of cool stuff. And all of a sudden, horn started honking and I experienced my very first birthday parade.
Birthday parade?
Uh-huh. Oh, look.
Birthday parades are awesome. See, these are the blessings of a pandemic birthday because a birthday parade can only happen during a pandemic. Because any other time that you have a birthday and your friends just drive by and huck your presents out the window is a really weird way to do a birthday. But during a pandemic, it is a beautiful way to do a birthday. And I want to thank especially the Fluth family. All three cars of Fluth hucked toilet paper out at my yard. And I want you to know it has already gone to very good use. So appreciate that, Fluth, for being thoughtful of that gift that keeps on giving. And it's a gift. Again, like when would a roll of toilet paper be like something that you would get on your birthday and be excited about it? But that's what we got, and we're thankful. People threw baked goods at us and candy, and even my mom drove by. It was great to see her and my dad, and she made a chocolate cream pie, and so, you know, we passed that off, and it's my favorite dessert, and my mom makes an amazing chocolate cream pie on top. It's real whipped cream, and she's got she has like shaved chocolate on top, and it's chocolate that had chili in it, so it's a little spice. Oh, man, it was good. So we had all that for the party in the house, and instead of, you know, my parents being able to be there, we just video called them in, so they got to be a part of the candle thing and the gift thing, and I had the best birthday ever. So thanks especially to Nancy Mattson and Jesse Copeland. Nancy for coming up with the idea, and Jesse as well for helping orchestrate the whole thing. But so cool to see that line of cars down the street, and it's just affirming to me what a wonderful way to have a birthday. So having a birthday during a pandemic was great for me, and it'll be memories that I will remember forever. So it was great. In fact, just Sunday after, I think it was, it was Dixon Brooks. I think he had birthday on Sunday. We did a drive-by there. I tell you, drive-by birthdays are kind of cool because people are like, hey, come to my birthday party. And you're like, I don't know if I have time to come to my birthday. If all you have to do is drive by their house and huck their present out the window, dude, who doesn't have time for that? And that's actually kind of fun to do. So happy birthday to all of you. I hope you all have birthday parades. Let me know about it because I would love to drive by and just throw stuff at you. So good times, and really enjoyed it. This week also was Administrative Professionals Week. Really strange for administrative professionals because the work situation is really different. And here at Hillcrest, we've got Jen Simons, and she's been with us many, many years now, does an amazing job around here doing all those administrative kinds of things. I was with Jen on Wednesday, which Wednesday is the actual day. It's kind of a week, but Wednesday is the day. And normally we go out to lunch as a staff and, you know, we really whoop it up. But on this particular day, Jen was here and she was helping me with recording Tarina's Sunday school message, as well as her and Kelsey were doing some songs, and we were recording all that and then editing all of that. And the entire time that Jen is here, I didn't say once like happy Administrative Professionals Day. I didn't even get her a bottle of water. Like I was completely spaced that was what was going on. And, you know, you need someone to remind you, but your administrative, you know, professional shouldn't have to remind you of Administrative Professionals Day. So I felt terrible afterwards because Jen had left, and I went to my office and there was a card on my desk that Pastor Brian had put there, and the staff had already signed it. It was for Administrative Professionals Day. I'm like, oh, what a dope. So I sat down and I signed the card. And if you don't know who Jen Simons is, this is a picture of Jen. This is probably just a couple years ago. But here's what I wrote in her card. Happy birthday, Jen. Happy birthday, Jen. Not her birthday. It's Administrative Professionals Day. oh, wish we could all go out and eat together. I guess I have my priorities straight there. But, you know, maybe we'll do it for all the missed birthdays when this thing is over. Oh, my goodness. What a dope. So, Pastor Brian, when he got the card, he immediately texted that picture to me and said, what? And I'm like, oh, my goodness. And then, of course, Jen finds out about it. I sent a text to Jen, too. And we just decided, yeah, just keep the card as is. Everybody else signed it. Happy, you know, Administrative Professionals Day. And there's Pastor Doug's thing. Happy birthday. Folks, I'm losing it. I am coming undone at the seams. So you never know what I might say. You never know what I might do. But, you know, I made it to tonight. So we're at Hillcrest Live. So far, I don't think I'm in too much trouble. So that's a good thing. But Jen Simons, happy Administrative Professionals Day and happy early, happy birthday. Because just thinking of you, awesome. She does a great job for us. So that's what's been going on this week. Questions. I like to take questions. So each week, if you have questions about things, you can send them my way. You can certainly comment on Facebook, but you can also comment by sending me an email or Facebook message or text message or whatever way you want to get a question to me. And I will answer your question live on Thursday night. And if there's a lot of questions, I'll just have to pick some of them. But since I didn't ask for any questions ahead of time, and I don't have any of those specifically, I want to answer a question that came on our YouTube page during one of TK's or around the time that TK was teaching last night. And this comes from Thomas Bauer. So Thomas, I replied on YouTube to you telling you I was going to answer it tonight. So if you're watching and you didn't get that message, yeah, it's all about you, buddy. So this is his question. He said, when are we meeting on Sunday as a group? Now, he probably is specifically meaning 180, not necessarily church. But Thomas, I want to answer that for all of us here at Hillcrest as simply as I can. We don't know. I wish we knew, but we don't know. Nobody knows. Michael Jordan doesn't know. The Dallas Cowboys don't know. Mike Tyson doesn't know. Shaq doesn't know. Christy Gnome doesn't know. Donald Trump doesn't know. Garden Gnomes don't know. City of Sioux Falls doesn't know. Mayor Tin Hankin doesn't know. Pastor Doug doesn't know. Pastor Doug's wife doesn't know. I mean, if she doesn't know, who knows? So, all I can tell you is this. As soon as we're able to, we are going to meet together again. It may be a month, 2 months, 3 months, or more. But it's going to be whatever it is. And so we're going to do our best to connect, to have some fun, to enjoy each other, to try and remember what each other look like, and to do our very, very best that the day we all come back together, that we don't say to so many other people, wow, you put on some weight during the COVID-19. Because, yeah, nobody needs to hear that. But we're going to come together as soon as we can. Whenever it's safe, we're going to. But right now, we have to do it this way because it's the safety of people, and people matter, and we got to do our part. And as Christians, our part is keeping others. That's how we can love our community right now. Wash our hands, wear our masks, stay home as often as possible, and don't cram together 400 or 500 people in one building. And so when we're ready, Thomas, we'll get together. I know you're looking forward to that, and we are too. So that's our question for the week. So, you ever seen those pictures I referenced earlier that are kind of funny pictures? Sometimes there's text on them, or sometimes it's a video with text, and they're called memes, and people share them around. And as I'm doing my work on the internet, I come across them all the time. People are always sending them to me, and some of them are just stinking hilarious. And I see a lot of them. So, what I wanted to do is each week, since I have so many I come across, I wanted to share the best memes of the week. Now, some people don't even know how they're pronounced if they haven't heard someone talk about them before. And I know they're called memes, but I hate that term. I prefer to call things sometimes by a name different than what they really are. So I prefer to call them memes. So I want to share the best memes with you each week. that I've come across, and today I've got a few for you, but in this segment, we're calling this one the best memes this week.
This is a meme. I did not start this meme. I did not make this meme, and I did not share this meme.
The way to pronounce this word is meme. It's not mem, it's not meme, it's meme.
Seriously, there's people online, that's for real. So she's educating all of us. Meme. So here's a few of them. These are all centered around the same subject matter, which happens to be masks. Because we were told early on that we needed to wear masks in order to keep ourselves healthy and keep ourselves safe from this coronavirus. And the only mask apparently that was worth even putting on our face was some mask called an N95 that none of us knew what that was at the time. But we were told any other mask or even respirator was not going to be good if it was not at least N95 or better. So dust masks were a joke. Then, of course, as time went on, there were no masks available. In fact, even for our medical professionals, they do not have masks available. They don't have N95 masks, many of them, to wear. And so they have resorted to all other kinds of masks, including just basic dust masks. And so the CDC has decided, well, apparently we're telling everyone to wear a mask and you can't wear a mask. So now we're going to tell you, apparently, all you have to do is wear a t-shirt over your face and you're good to go. I don't know. But people are now fashioning masks out of anything. There's designs and patterns online on how to sew your own masks. Even if you can't sew, they show you how to do it with thread glue. But if you are not a seamstress and you don't have thread glue, or you know, you just don't know how to do it, you're just not a crafty person, there are people that are coming up with unique ways to do masks. And so it's our responsibility to do the best we can to make whatever kind of mask we can when we go out into the public. And so I want to show you a couple memes that I thought were interesting on masks. Now, obviously, we're trying to keep the virus out. And so this guy made a mask, definitely like an anti-virus mask. Yeah. So obviously, that's not going to work very well. Norton may be able to help you with some kind of viruses, but apparently not that virus. You actually need something that's going to catch something. Like if you cough, it has to be able to catch it. So this guy made what he calls a coffee filter mask. Get it? Coffee. C-O. Yeah. Coffee. Hey, you know what? People have a lot of time on their hands, so this is what they're coming up with. Sometimes you end up going to the store and you're like, oh man, I forgot my crocheted mask that my 9-year-old niece made for me. I left it at home and here I am at the store and I have to go in and I don't have a mask. So what am I going to use? And you start rummaging around the car. Like, do I have anything that I can wear other than pulling my shirt up over my head to go into this grocery store? And you find, you know, maybe there's some like oversized water bottle that, you know, has been rolling around, you know, in the side seat or in your trunk for a while. That is all you need to make a mask, because that's what this guy did. That's right. That is the water bottle face mask. Very, very protective. Fogs up a little bit, so gotta be careful with that. But careful in the freezer section, I guess. I have another mask that I want to show you, and I debated whether to show you this mask or not. And I made a promise to my wife that I would stay away of certain subject matter. And I want to keep that promise. So I am not going to comment on this mask. Okay, I'm just going to show it to you. It's just a mask someone's wearing. I'm just going to show it to you, but no comment. I promise. Just... So many things I want to say. I won't say them. Go to my happy place. You like the Hallmark Channel? You like those movies that have those really deep soundtracks and the acting and the writing are all designed for one central purpose: to make whoever's watching the movie or the show cry. Yes, that is the focus of the Hallmark Channel. I think when you subscribe to it, it should come with a box of tissues. The whole point of these is just to get an emotional, and I get it. Like, some people love that kind of stuff. I'm not much of a, I'm just not a Hallmark Channel kind of guy. Now, I get it. It probably would do me good to focus on watching things like the Hallmark Channel instead of, Forged in Fire and Wicked Tuna and, you know, the History Channel, the Vikings. Not the football team. I mean, something cool worth watching. Like, you know, actual Vikings. I would probably benefit from some Hallmark Channel stuff. I just don't like to cry. I'm just not into it. It's not my thing. And I don't like to have those emotional responses necessarily. But I get it. Some people do. And so I want each week to do my very best to bring something to you that warms your heart. That is, you know, a Hallmark moment of some sort. I'm not the best at finding these, so if you come across them, please send them my way. The one I'm going to show you today is one that was sent to me, and someone said how like amazing and emotional it was, so I know it kind of fits the bill, and so I want to share that with you in a segment that we are calling the Hallmark Moment.
It's a movie. Your face is white, Kylie.
Well, why don't you guys finish the movie and see if you're still crying?
Okay.
Piano music just gets you right there, doesn't it? Well, there is a story that I want to show you. It's a clip that came from News 7 in Australia. And this family has a grandmother who has Alzheimer's. And as a result of the pandemic, her routine, her schedule has been greatly changed. And for many Alzheimer's patients, that schedule, that routine is what kind of keeps them healthy, mentally healthy. And with the disruption of it, things weren't going well. And, you know, doctors, people weren't sure what to do. But this family stepped it up and figured out how to address the needs that the grandma had to help her have the healthiest and best outcome possible during this pandemic. So take a look at this clip.
Hendrika van Genderen usually pops to Coles once a week. These days, she can't. Now, she doesn't need to.
Shopping at home.
Yeah, we've made a shopping centre at home, especially for you.
Her son set this up in their Central Coast home.
We've got your walker, so we can use this to put the shopping in.
Her very own Coles. The 87-year-old has Alzheimer's and dementia. Shopping once a week kept her brain active. Son Jason wasn't about to let that stop.
What if we just take the two we need and then we leave the rest for other people?
The simple practice of going to the shops or having a cup of coffee at a certain time of the day, they mean a lot to that person because they're things that they can hold on to and remember.
Is it all my shopping?
The touching video starring the whole family has been shared thousands of times.
Have a good day, madam.
Thank you very much.
Touching story, I know. Truly, though, what a cool story, like, that the family figured that out and all got on board with doing the best they could to help their grandma out. So I love these stories that are happening during this time as people are together. You hear all kinds of crazy stories, but ones like these are great because it just shows you that, you know, humanity is alive and well. Love for others is alive and well, and definitely displayed in that story. Now, before that was sent to me, I was working on one that I had come across already. So I figured I might as well show it to you because though I'm not the best at picking these Hallmark moments, I think I nailed this one, hit it out of the park. So there's another story from Germany about a zoo there in Germany. And the town, I'm not going to get the name right, but it's It's New Munster, N-E-U-M-U with umlauts, N-S-T-E-R, New Munster. And it is struggling. The zoo is struggling because the supply chains for food have been diminished. And then on top of that, the guests coming to the zoo have dropped off, and they are in a tremendous crisis as a zoo. And CNN reported that New Munster Zoo is home to over 700 animals, and there's about over 100 species represented in these 700 animals. And they have come up with a brilliant way to save their zoo. So this is what they've come up with. And I just think, this is amazing. Like, the creativity of people, who wants to lose their zoo? I mean, everybody cheering on, like, we want to save the zoo. And they have figured out how to do it. So the actual director of the zoo told everyone what the plan was. And so this is what they're going to do. They are going to feed some of their animals to the other animals. What? Yes, they're going to feed some of their animals to other animals, like baby female sea lion Joji. She will soon become food for other animals, while some other animal's baby will become food for Joji's mother, Iki. That's Iki and Joji. Now, the zoo also said that which animals were going to be designated for food hadn't been itemized out yet. They hadn't put the list together on who was first and that kind of thing. They did say this. They did say that the 12-foot-tall polar bear named Vitus, he would be the last one to go. So, way to go, Germany. Wow. See? Touching, right? Told you. Maybe I don't need your submissions. I got this, right? I got that. Hallmark moments? I got it. Well, this is going to wrap up our first pilot episode of Hillcrest Live. So as I kind of get ready to sign off here, I want to ask you, do you want to have another episode? Because if you do, you're going to have to tell me that. So in the comments below, you just have to say, yes, do another episode. Now, if you do not want there to be another episode of Hillcrest Live, you also need to put that in the comments, because if we don't want Hillcrest Live, then I won't do them. And just be gentle, okay? But yes, if people say, forget this thing, then forget it, we won't do it. So it's up to you. All 50 some odd of you, that are watching with family and friends, however that might be, you let me know, and that will determine whether we have it or not. Now, if we do continue this and you have ideas for segments or ideas for the segments that I've kind of, debuted today, send them to me. Let me know about them. If you want to be one of the call-in guests on a video chat, like, we will do that. Like, one way or another, we want to connect you into this and have you be a part of this as much as possible if this is something that we are going to continue doing. I had a ton of fun doing this, had a ton of fun getting ready for it. So I do want to thank you for tuning in and making it all the way to the end. Those of you troopers that made it with me all the way to the end of this thing. This coming Sunday, I'm going to be working on the last message of the I Deserve It series. And this is the very last one of I Deserve It. And we're going to be looking at the title for the one this Sunday is I deserve to be counted out, but God gave me another chance. He gave me another chance. And I think sometimes we think, we've messed up. We're not everything we need to be. And somehow we have been excluded, or we have made it to where we're not going to be a part of this thing. And so I want to show you a story, one of the coolest stories, teachings in the Bible that I love. And it's about Peter. And Peter royally messed up. I royally mess up. I think that's why I like Peter's story so much, is because there's redemption in it, and Jesus shows that to Peter. And so we're going to talk about that this Sunday. And if you walk away from anything this Sunday, my hope is that I get this across. This would be my prayer for that, is that you understand that failure in life is an event, and it's never a person. So that'll be our focus for this Sunday. Well, as I get ready to leave you tonight to do whatever it is you're doing, remember this. The Lord has given you two ends, one for sitting and one for thinking. and your success in life depends on which one you use. Heads you win, tails you lose.